I thank Dr. Chandak and all the expert panel to give me this opportunity to talk about this FROSH approach. And we start with this simple case. She's a 26-year-old female, had a road traffic accident. It was close fracture. There is no medial tenderness, no medial bruise. These are her x-rays, AP lateral and oblique. As we all can see, there is a lateral condyle fracture. The CT scan shows at least two, one anterolateral and one posterolateral fragments. The posterolateral looks to be a bigger fragment. And if we observe the lateral x-ray more closely, we can see that the articular surface has depressed in such a way that the joint surface is facing anteriorly. It is probably 70 degrees rotated. The same patient, we are seeing a coronal CT scan, which shows that the major fragment is the posterolateral piece, which is probably accounting for 70% of the lateral condyle. And then the coronal sections also show that the posterolateral fragment is significantly large, and we can see that it is abutting to the head of the fibula. The fragment has displaced posteriorly and it is wedged between the intact proximal fibula and tibia. And on the sagittal CT scan, we can also see an element of intercondylar fracture. Probably it is looks like undisplaced or minimally displaced, but on 3D CT scan, we can see the intercondylar fracture. So, summary of our case is that it's a lateral condyle fracture. There is a medial condyle which is intact. MCL clinically is intact. There is comminution. So, we have at least three pieces, anterior intercondylar piece. Then we have the lateral condylar wafer thin like piece over here. And we have a large like piece over here. And the purpose of our approach, what we have to get from our approach is we should be able to visualize all the three fragments and we should be able to reduce simultaneously each in relation to the other. The intraarticular reduction should be preferably under vision, and posterolateral exposure most likely will be necessary to reduce, manipulate the large fragment and maybe fix it from behind if necessary. So we now need an anterolateral approach to fix a strong implant because we don't have a strong implant from the posterolateral side. But we also need a posterolateral approach for reduction. So the combination of the two, the posterolateral as well as anterolateral, that is what we get as a FROSH approach. And it is nothing but 1 plus 1 equal to 2. So if you can do a posterolateral, if you can do anterolateral, then you do a FROSH approach. The incision is somewhat in between the two. We have an anterior and a posterior window, the anterolateral arthrotomy done here and the posterolateral work done over here. The head of the fibula is the most important landmark. And the purpose that this approach was devised was because previously the head of the fibula osteotomy was done to expose the entire lateral condyle, and it was found to be very damaging. And there were a lot of problems with fibular head osteotomies, including the peroneal nerve involvement. So preserving the lateral collateral ligament and biceps femoris attachment, we can approach the entire condyle with this FROSH approach. Important anatomical landmarks here. First and foremost, we have to understand this is the X-ray being seen. I mean, this is a knee seen from behind. The two important muscles that we will be encountering posteriorly will be the popliteus muscle and the soleus muscle. And this is the area from where the soleus will be erased downwards. And once that is done, we will be encountering a medial geniculate vessel, most likely the lateral inferior medial geniculate vessel over here, which may require cauterization or ligation. So in a nutshell, this is how the posterolateral window will be from anatomical point of view. The important thing here, the important caveat here is the anterior tibial vessels, which are going to start from the popliteal vessels and enter into the anterior interosseous, enter into anterior compartment from the interosseous space. So if we look at the posterior view of the knee, this is the general depiction of the anterior interosseous, anterior tibial vessels, how they start from the popliteal vessels. So over here, if this is how the popliteal vessel would be located with the retractors in place, this is where the anterior tibial vessels will be crossing obliquely into the anterior interosseous space. And we have to be sure that we don't damage them. On an anatomical specimen, on a dissection specimen, this is where that anterior tibial vessels will be in relation to the head of the fibula. And in a clinical scenario, in the operative theater, this is where those anterior tibial vessels are. this is our posterior lateral window, this is the anterotibial vessel, and this limits our distal extension of the posterior lateral window. So now let's start. This is a patient in a lateral position. These anatomical landmarks have been marked. The head of the fibula is the most important landmark. We as surgeons are standing behind the patient. The patient is on a radiolucent table. There is a bolster beneath the knee, which already exists a varus strain so that the lateral joint can be visualized better. The incision is a linear incision along the level of fibula. The fibular head is our landmark. We start 4 centimeters proximal to the joint line and go distally along the fibular shaft like this. It's a linear long straight incision. And we make sure that we raise both the flaps thick. The thick flaps, because we don't want wound necrosis. These are long incisions. This is the extensile approach. So make sure that we don't, we don't affect the vascularity of our skin flaps. The most important structure to be identified immediately after the skin incision and raising the flaps is the peroneal nerve. And it is quite superficial. And so we have to be very careful that we don't damage the peroneal nerve. As you can see, it has been highlighted in this picture. Now, there are 2 steps in the FROS approach. First step is the anterolateral window, which is the classic anterolateral approach, which we do by splitting the iliotibial band. We do the submeniscal arthrotomy to visualize the articular surface. So in this picture, this is the front portion, the patella, the femur, the leg. This is our anterolateral arthrotomy. If I zoom it, this is how it looks. So this is the meniscus. You can use sutures and retract the meniscus to have a better visualization. You already have a varus strain because of the bolster beneath the medial side. And you can just clean out the joint and then you can inspect the articular surface and you will be able to see most of the articular surface. The important point I want to highlight here is that the usually lateral condyle or anterolateral portion of that lateral condyle is a very thin wafer-like structure. And if we erase all the soft tissues from it, then it becomes avascular. So we should minimize the soft tissue stripping from the anterolateral condyle fragment. Now we go to the posterolateral side. So the anterolateral arthrotomy, as you can see over here, is already done. Now we are going to the posterolateral part, and the peroneal nerve is our lighthouse. It is the most important landmark. We have to identify the peroneal nerve, and then everything else begins from there. So once we have cut the deep fascia posterolaterally and the peroneal nerve already being protected while cutting the deep fascia, we will be seeing the lateral head of gastrocnemius, which in this has been retracted with the retractor so that the muscles underneath are visualized. And what are they? The important muscle here is the popliteus muscle, which is this, the popliteus with its tendon. And the second important muscle here is the soleus muscle, which has been cut from this area. This is our fibular head. So from the fibular head posteriorly, just behind the peroneal nerve, and we start cutting the soleus muscle and we erase it downwards. How much? Till we reach the anterotibial vessels. So this is how we do the posterolateral window, and then we can see the posterolateral fragment very clearly from our posterolateral window. Now, once that posterolateral fragment has been visualized, we have to do the reduction. Now, reduction is done from the front because we have to lift from the front. But you can see here that I have used a spike to push from behind because the posterior soft tissue hinge is broken. And by elevating this, we also need to push it into the front. So I am disengaging. If you correlate with the CT scan, this is our condyle, the major posterolateral piece facing in the front. This is our anterolateral, this piece, which has been opened by using a open book sort of maneuver so that the condyle is very well visualized. And before we try to elevate, try to get as much bone as possible with the articular fragment. So this, I am elevating the articular fragment. And as you all can see, it has been elevated with a large chunk of bone. There is a pressure from behind with my spike so that the fragment doesn't push posteriorly. And the elastic recoil of the proximal fibula also helps to push the fragment in the front. As you also can make out, I have hardly erased any periosteum from the anterolateral fragment, if all of you can make out over here. So moving forward, let us see how it looks on the X-ray. So this was the pre-surgery X-ray. Unfortunately, you can see the intercondylar fragment has displaced slightly. And this is the view after reduction. So now you can see that this fragment has been elevated well, and in the AP view you can see the perfect profile of the posterolateral fragment and the lateral condyle fragment here, and you can make out the margins of the meniscus. So provisional fixation with the K wire, and then we go ahead to put the plate, but we also need to make sure that posterolateral to anterolateral fragment is held with the pointed clamp. So the posterior prong is from the posterior window, the anterior prong is from the anterior window, and this is how the plate has been put. Apart from that, the intercondylar fragment also can be visualized from your anterolateral arthrotomy. So it has been reduced and it has been fixed provisionally with a K wire, and I'm going to put a screw subsequently into it. So moving ahead with the fixation, the reduction is confirmed in multiple views, and then the fixation is done this way. The fixation is straightforward. You can see that three of the four raft screws are engaging the posterolateral fragment. So I did not put a posterolateral plate because it was a large fragment. It was very well held with the raft plate, and the raft plate is significantly strong plate. So I have just put a single raft plate. Before closure, this is how things look. This is our anterolateral arthrotomy over here, an anterior split to take the plate. But you can see that this portion, the anterior portion of the lateral condyle, has not been stripped from the periosteum. It is extra periosteal plate that I have put in this patient. A close view, and you can also see the intercondylar piece which was held with the screw. And after closure, the arthrotomy closure, this is how it looks from the anterior side. From the posterior side, this is the posterior window which we used for reduction and putting the clamp. This is the head of the fibula, so you can get a orientation. This is the biceps and the lateral collateral ligament, which is absolutely intact. This is our peroneal nerve, and this is the soleus muscle, the lateral head of gastrocnemius and soleus. These are the two muscles which have been sutured back. This is our post-operative X-ray. The intercondylar seems to be not perfectly aligned. Over a period of 3 months, the patient underwent perfect recovery. The wound healed perfectly, and you can see that the fracture has also healed in anatomical position. Now, sometimes you may require a plate on the posterolateral side. So this case I am sharing with permission from Jignesh Bhai because it is his case. This is the place where the posterior cortex is a separate fragment. And just by reducing this condyle, we are not going to be able to support this posterior cortex, this marginal fracture of the posterior cortex. So here he has reduced, this is the articular portion, this is the marginal portion. So having reduced the articular portion and stabilized it with K-wire, this cortex he has supported with a small plate. And you can see the neurovascular bundle is so much near. So the plate has to be really small, really short. We cannot use long plate on this direction. Now, another case, this is the last case where, again, you see a lateral condyle which is badly comminuted, a medial condyle which is good. The lateral condyle is showing multiple fragments. This is the CT scan. So you can see the central piece has caved in, and then there are four peripheral pieces which have blown out. You can also see a long split on the posterolateral aspect in the tibia, and this marginal piece, which will have to be addressed from the posterior side only. There is no way we can address it by any suprafibular or anterolateral approach. This is another view of that same fragment, and this is the approach, the Frost approach. So this is the posterolateral window. You can see this is the remaining of the soleus, and this is the screw, that one of the three interfragmentary screws that I have passed from behind, two screws holding that marginal fragment. I would have put a plate, but I did not want to because it was a bulky muscular patient and it was difficult to retract, and I was worried about the anterior vessels. So I put three screws, two 6.5 cc screws. They held it well. And then the support was given with the anterior raft plate. This is the post-op X-ray. You will be thinking that this screw is intra-articular, but as it is going along the slope of the tibia, it is actually absolute subchondral screw. You can see even in the lateral view. This is the patient's wound healing at the time of suture removal at 3 weeks, and this is the movement, and then patient went on for an uneventful recovery. So friends, to summarize the Frost approach, I would use it for lateral condyle fragment fracture with coronal split fragments, or a posterior lateral displaced condylar fragment which is not more than 5 cm, because beyond that I will not be able to expose by the posterolateral window. badly comminuted lateral condyle fracture as a part of bicondylar fracture, you can use this approach to fix entire lateral condyle. And this marginal or rim fractures of the posterior lateral condyle also, if you want to address along with the anterior part. So in short, whenever you feel that the lateral condyle requires a rough plate, but some posterior lateral work, then you can use this cross approach. The technical tips, long incision is recommended so that you don't put a lot of strain or stretch on the retraction. Thick flaps, anterior and posterior. Superficial, peroneal nerve is quite superficial, so you should be aware, be gentle in putting your incision. The distal extent is limited by anterior tibial vessels. Watch out for it, don't damage them. Visualize the reduction by anterolateral arthrotomy. You don't visualize from behind, you visualize from the front. And re-suture attachments of the soleus and meniscotibial ligament. Thank you very much.